you know, it's sort of one over just finished and the other starts. So you've just had the time where the captains have moved the field a little bit. Bowlers are ready, fielders are ready, and so we go. Three of the best speakers, perhaps, in this day and age of international cricket in this session. Arguably, three of the best commentators in the business, and of course, three of the best players to have played the game. Michael Clarke, Sourav Ganguly, Shane Warne, at the Salaam Cricket Conclave in the London Business School. Vikrant, it doesn't get better than this.
And normally, we have two bowlers bowling to a batsman, but you've got one bowler bowling to two outstanding batsmen.
Correct. And Sourav, as usual, was sitting in the middle. And when it was 11:29, Michael said, "So where is Dada?" And I was like, "He made Steve Waugh wait for you at the toss. He's now trying to make you and Shane wait for you for the session."
But did actually anybody wait? I was at the parking at 11:29. You know, when they say 11:30, I mean 11:30. I don't come at 11:25 and I don't come at 11:35.
So it's all about timing.
I come at 11:30.
It's all about your
but
time.
It's such a pleasure to see Shane again, Michael again. Michael has become half Indian.
Correct.
In the last 4 months. But Shane, absolute champion. Such a pleasure to see you again.
Lovely to see you too, Sourav and Pup. I mean, Sourav, when you're talking about the toss, I loved it that he was late for the toss.
You did?
It was like you, basically. It was fantastic. You know, Steve Waugh, you're strange. You can wait. This is on my terms. This is my turf. And I'll turn up when I want to turn up. I absolutely loved it.
That's Shane Warne for you.
But he still doesn't believe he did that on purpose.
But I can bet you.
Listen to him.
But I can bet you when he took that ball at Eden Gardens and he was bowling to me outside the rough on that off stump in the test match, every time he remembered me, "You better learn to play the game in the right manner. You better be at the toss at the right time." And that's what he says now. So great to hear that.
I didn't like it. I didn't like it at the time when I was playing against him. But I look back at it and I respect it. It was fantastic.
I think
I got none for 180 that game too. So
you think it was deliberate?
Yeah, of course it was. He won't say it now, but it was. He's not going to rock up late.
Come on,
toss. Sarah. Of course
Come
it
on.
Was.
Was it deliberate? It was.
Actually, a couple of times I left my blazer in the dressing room. So I had to go back and get it.
I've used plenty of excuses for many different things too. Sorry. Well, let's just say he did it on purpose and it was wonderful.
But I must tell you one thing. As I turned around Regent's Park and entered Hanover Terrace, the police caught me and said, "Did you see a man with suit and very good looking and with one of the best cars in the town?" I said, "Who's that?" He said, "He's got a black Bentley and he was driving at 100 miles an hour next to the Sussex Place Garden."
And the car's parked there.
I said, "Yeah, I know who you're talking about and I'm seeing him in 5 minutes, but you need to let him go because he's bowled too many English batsmen out. You know, 100 meters from here, the first delivery to Mike Gehring, which year was it?
That was old traffic. 93.
You know, took the world by storm. So you expect him to come to Sussex Gardens and drive at 100 miles an hour. And you got to let him do that because that delivery made English cricket lose ashes for the next 10 years.
Michael, you've grown up watching these two. Now you're sort of watching these two just take the stage.
Yeah, I love it. It's good. I can sit back and watch like I used to as a young boy. I guess that's probably one of the things I'm most proud of through my career, that the players that I idolised as a young boy playing cricket, I was lucky enough to play with and against. So I got to play against Sourav. I got to play with Shane. And I think this is a great example of why you play cricket. At the time, I will never forget how competitive Shane Warne and Sourav Ganguly were. Warney wanted to get him out. Sourav was a wonderful player of spin, as good as any left-hander, in my opinion. They were so competitive on the field, but you see this friendship and this relationship now, and that's why the game is so special. And I think about big tournaments like this, the Champions Trophy, and the recent Test Series in India between Australia and India, and there's a lot of talk in the media about how competitive these two teams were. Steve Smith, Virat Kohli, you know, they're not friends or they're not getting on. That's, you love the game so much and you want to win and you're so passionate about helping your country be successful. That's why you play so hard on the field. But Steve Smith and Virat Kohli will be no different to these two in 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, when they're sitting together like this talking about good times. You know, because of how competitive we all are with each other, that's what makes us respect each other. And as a young boy growing up watching these two, that's why I idolise these two.
And you know, I went through a phase when I was playing regularly with Shane. I used to see him everywhere. You know, he used to play in Southampton, and I used to play in Glamorgan. He used to play for Hampshire, and I used to play for Glamorgan, and he sledged me everywhere. You know, I saw him at the IPL game, Rajasthan Royals by against Kolkata Knight Riders. Shane Warne was sledging. The first thing he did when he walked out of the dressing room, looked at me and started sledging me right till the toss. And then when I saw him in Glamorgan at the Rose Bowl, he He walked down the steps and he saw me coming out. We were playing for different counties and he was just unbelievable with the ball for them. The first thing he did was sledging. So we went through a period of 10 years where every time we looked at each other and Shane had something to say. But, you know, he was an absolute champion. You know, I have not seen a spinner bowl so well in my life. You know, I've seen Murali, I've seen him, and I was fortunate enough to bat against both, score some runs against both. But as I see modern day cricket, unbelievable.
He sledged you for 10 years and you mean to say you were quiet?
No, I did it as well because you had no choice.
I was kind of, let me say, sir, I've never said a word back, of course. You can imagine, can't you? It was, look, as I said earlier before these guys got here, Sourav Ganguly, Dravid, Laxman, Tendulkar and Sehwag, those five guys that India had, don't ever unappreciate how good they were. You talked about the modern day Indian side and would you like to, you asked me the question, would I rather bowl to the current day Indian side or these guys? Please. I think I'd much rather bowl to this current day Indian side. You have to bowl to these guys all the time. They get through, they'd smash McGrath all over the place or wherever else the quicks was. They'd be all on 30 or 40. Then they'd run down in Dongya for six the first over. These guys were quality players. And sometimes I think people don't appreciate how good they actually were. And you say that, you know, you struggled a bit in India. Yeah, I did. Because these guys were too good and they were so good. And maybe you guys don't appreciate just how good they were. And I mean, Sourav was an amazing player. So when I saw him destroy that many spinners, it was not funny. He was fantastic. And one of my ways that I wanted to try and get into Sourav was to make sure if I sledged him, I would actually try and put him off his game, but actually made him more determined. So that shows me why he was such a good captain too, because he had that determination. He had that little bit of cunningness in him. And the way he led his side, I thought it was the first time. That was when India became one of the better sides in the world and one of the best sides in the world under Sourav. He gave him a toughness. All the Indian players a toughness that they wouldn't take a backward step against anyone. And they had the firepower. And I've said that publicly before about Sourav. It's not because he's sitting here. I like to talk about his hair and how good it's looking at the moment, but
it's well concealed.
He's looking wonderful, yeah. Isn't he? His hair looking great. You know, we could talk about those sort of things rather than say how good
he's an ambassador to that company, so you know why is he saying
he's
Isn't he sledging you again? Ask him, am I right or am I wrong?
Yeah, no, I'm the face of Advanced Air Studio.
Absolutely. See where he talks it in the London Business School.
And don't forget, if anyone wants a consultation, they're free.
Sort of, Michael did mention about the Virat Kohli versus Anil Kumble thing. Now, you're going to be in that hot seat very soon. Did you ever anticipate that there'll be a rerun?
I don't want to be in that hot seat. And I've told them that, listen, you need to keep me out of this. Because 1 year ago, I did all the interviews.
So, speaking
to everyone, I said, you sort it out and you decide who you want. We'll support it.
No, but then did you ever anticipate a situation like this, a rerun of Greg Chappell, the thing that happened in 2002? Did you ever imagine it'll happen again in Indian cricket this?
Really, honestly, Vikrant, I don't know how far it is. And I've not gone to the depth of it. I've just been reading in the media. And to be honest, I would actually want to hear it from the horse's mouth before.
But the media says that you've spoken to the captain.
No, I've not spoken to anyone. And I don't think this is the right place to speak because they're playing a Champions Trophy in 2 days' time. So I haven't met Virat. I just said hello to him at the ground. And you need to know what's the exact situation, because I don't think anyone should comment or anyone should talk about anything about what's happening before they actually get to know. And I'm in that position because I'm far away from the dressing room. And I really don't know what is there. And in every relationship, you know, whether you're a coach, whether you're a captain, you know, you had Warne, Waugh, Gilchrist in the same dressing room. You know, you had Ganguly, Tendulkar, Dravid, or Michael Clarke, or Ricky Ponting, or the best cricketers in the same dressing room. There will be difference of opinions. Because
there should be.
Yeah, there should be. Because, you know, because they're champions. You know, look at Shane Warne, what he did for Australia during that period. You know, Australia was the number one team in the world because they had someone like Shane Warne bowling after 20 overs with that Kookaburra ball, where it's a different ball game once that seam goes away. So there will be differences of opinion. You don't expect, you make Shane Warne the coach of a national team, or you make Michael Clarke the coach of the national team. You don't expect him to sit at the back seat of the dressing room and just watch everything, have breakfast and tea and snacks, because they have so much self-pride that they want to make a difference. And it's the same thing with Anil Kumble. It's the same thing with Virat Kohli. You know, because they want to win. When India will lose now, they'll say it's Virat Kohli's team, it's Anil Kumble's team. And it's a lot of self-respect going around there. So there will be opinions. There will be differences. You just got to sit at one place and take it forward.
So you mean it can be subjective vis-a-vis different personalities?
It has to happen, you know. Otherwise, you'll only be playing with the deaf and the dumb, who can't talk and who can't hear. And you don't want to have that sort of a situation.
Michael, can I just say just one thing on that? I think it's really important that the coach and the captain not disagree, but have debate. Because one thing is they might not agree with things, but there's a respect for each other. If there's a respect from each other, the chats and the conversations that come, and at the moment, whether it be India or whoever, whatever team, that helps them get to the right decision. And in the end of the day, the captain should always have the right decision because it's his team. They might talk about the coach and all that stuff, but the captain, if you look back in history, they say Ian Chappell had this many test wins, Ricky Ponting this many wins, Sourav Ganguly had this many test wins. They don't talk about the coach. So at the end of the day, the captain always has to have the say, and he has to have the backing of the board. The coach, yes, they can disagree and stuff like that. They might not always get along. But as long as the captain is always in charge, not the coach, that's the most important thing.
Michael, that's a question that, in fact, I was about to ask both you and Shane. I mean, Sourav, yes, it's a very tricky position for him to be in because he's part of the advisory committee, yep, along with Sachin and Lakshman. And we know for a fact that we reported this story on India Today first, and we know for a fact, having spoken to the board members, and I'm putting it on record, that there is a problem. Mm. Now, if that happens just days before the Champions Trophy, how you as a captain would have addressed it? Will that affect India's performance against Pakistan? Does it have the potential to affect India's performance?
Well, two things. I think that was my question to Shane Warne earlier about how you leave this stuff off the field and go and play your cricket. That's what India need to do right now. They need to let this go, because when they take the field against Pakistan, when they walk off, it's still going to be here. It's not going to disappear. So let it go. Go and play the game. The players have a job to do, and that's to play their best cricket. That's their responsibility. I agree with Warnie as well. I guess this is one of the challenges that I found hard at the back end of my career. The Australian structure or system changed. So there was a lot more people put in charge of the captain, and I found that really difficult because, unlike Warnie, I grew up watching my father and watching these great players and looking at the captain of the cricket team and seeing that guy is accountable. The captain needs to be accountable for the wins, but more importantly, for the losses. So if there is an issue between Anil Kumble and Virat Kohli, they will sort it out, and it definitely needs to be sorted out. But what needs to happen is the captain needs to not necessarily get what you want. That's not the outcome. The outcome is winning. That's what's important. But the captain needs to feel like he's accountable. He can stand in front of the media, because he goes and does the press conference at the end of every game, not the coach, and say, yep, it's my fault that we lost the game.
The coach comes out when they're lost sometimes, and the coach comes out. Yeah, sometimes they send the coach.
The coach shouldn't, you know, especially when you lose. That's when the captain needs to be there. The captain is accountable. That's your responsibility as captain of a team. So I think it's really important that Virat, probably now more importantly than any other time, grabs his team and says, right, let's leave the speculation. Let's leave if there's an issue. Let's leave that off the field. Let's go and show how mentally strong we are as a team and go and win this tournament.
Well, incidentally, all three of you, unfortunately, have had documented incidents with the coaches, the respective coaches. Do you feel that the role of a coach is overstated in international cricket?
I think, my opinion, at the highest level, you cannot coach. Coach is not the right word. You coach a young boy or a young girl. You help develop their game. You help improve their knowledge of the game. You let them learn from your experiences. At the highest level, I think the best coach is the best man manager. I think it's about man manage each individual player in that team or in that squad to get the best out of them for the team's sake.
Sort of.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. It's about man management. It's about assessing situations and doing the minor things well. You know, you don't need to teach a Shane Warne how to bowl a leg spin. You know, John Buchanan was his coach. I don't know how much leg spin did he teach him, Bonnie? And did he teach you how to pitch outside the leg stump and hit from behind the stump?
Terry Jenner did.
He did.
Why did we have to bring up John Buchanan to Shane Warne?
Keep going. You're on a roll, sir. Keep going.
So he didn't. So from that point of view, I think, you know...
You enjoyed him at Kolkata Knight Riders, though.
Yeah, I had five captains at one stage. And, you know, as I looked up, as I walked into the ground and I saw one standing, sitting next behind the side screen, one at the square leg fence and the other at the point boundary, and Buchanan was on the bowler's arm at the boundary with the walkie-talkie. And poor McCullum at one stage was looking at the point fielder, point boundary, square leg boundary, long on boundary. I said, Chief, you have to look at what's going on at the 24 yards. But that's him, hopeless. Yeah, but that's what it is. So you deal with such situations and you go to work. But as Michael said very rightly, you have to manage the players well mentally. You have to keep them in good shape. Yes, you got to be tough. You got to make sure that they're training. You got to make sure that, you know, they're doing the right things. They're disciplined enough for the game. And I'm not saying just be overly disciplined, but be at the right state of mind to play the game. But yes, I don't think you need anything more than that. It's about managing the players mentally well.
Shane, this question is being reached.
Just to finish on that, yeah. I think there's a couple of real keys, and the boys have touched on it so far, but communication is the real key. The other thing about a so-called coach, I agree with the guys, I don't agree with the terminology of a coach, but I do believe there has to be someone there. And it all depends on what the role is, what the board, of whatever team it is, what the board see as his role. That's what they need to define. They need to define the coach's role, or I think manager of the team should be what they're called. And the manager of that team has to define, and to me, it's about preparing the players ready to play and say, here, captain, we've had our preparation, we're ready to go. So that might mean take someone off the side after the practice is finished and throw balls at him. Get the slippers to catch more balls. Whatever it might be, but prepare the team just to be ready and be there a bit like someone to talk to. And that's why
captain as well. Sorry to interrupt, Warnie, but you look at different captains. So let's say Ricky Ponting compared to me. We're two very different people, two very different captaincy styles. So the coach that Ricky Ponting would want might not necessarily be the best coach for me because we're two different personalities. So that's where the communication from the board with the captain to work out the role, the style of person the captain is.
But what you're then saying is, you know, if the captain wants somebody as coach and he doesn't get it, then that's a serious issue, right? Because communication...
The captain should sit with the boards to have an input. The board, sorry, let me say that again. The board should ask the captain what sort of style of coach he would like. And then together they form a team to make sure that they get the best players playing. I don't believe the coach should be a selector either, because I think that loses trust in the player going to a coach.
So let me take this forward before I let Vikrant ask the next one. Are you worried? If it's true, 2 days before the Champions Trophy, news coming out in the media, are you worried? Tell me honestly.
I'm not really, because I'll give you an example. In 2007 in England, we had come to play a three-test series, and we had Chandu Borde as a coach who was 74 years of age. You know, he couldn't give us slip catching, he couldn't hit the ball in the air. All he did was speak in the team meeting for 5 minutes and do the clapping. We went and beat England in the test series, and we went and beat them in the one-day series. We played South Africa in Ireland. We beat them in a three one-day series on absolute green pitches with Pollock, Entini and Callis and their full attack, which is even more than South African conditions. So that's where I come from. Yes, you need one. You need someone to help. But it's not the end-all and be-all of a cricket team. As I completely agree with Warne and Michael, it's the captain's team. A coach's job is to help the captain, to make sure that he stays in a good frame of mind to play the game. Because at the end of the day, when Virat Kohli walks out to bat in the Champions Trophy, he's India's best batsman. You know, he needs to be in a good frame of mind to make runs for India, because that is important. You win cricket matches because you score runs and take wickets. Yep. There's nothing more than that. And if the main player of the team is tired before he walks out to play a game, it'll be very, very hard for him. And I saw that when Australia came in. And I said that on air on one of our shows, that Virat has to take a little bit of a backseat because I find him too involved in everything. It takes the energy out of your system when you walk out to bat. And we saw that. He didn't get much runs in the series. So it's a balance which he will learn. But I am a firm believer that captain is the man of running cricket teams, and the coach needs to support him well.
Sourav, you know both of them very well, Virat and Anil Kumble as well. How do you think, as the situation pans out in the next 3 days, 4 days, or 2 weeks, how would the two of them and how should the two of them respond to the situation?
I really don't know, to be honest. You know, I'm too far away from it. Whether it's actually there or actually not there, whether there's a serious problem or not, I have no idea, because I have taken a decision to stay away from it, because, you know, with experience, I feel if you dig too deep during such a big tournament, it's just going to go down into everybody's head. So leave them alone. They're senior people. They're matured people. They both have reputations to deal with. And if India doesn't do well in the Champions Trophy, both of them will be criticized. So leave it to them and they will solve it.
That's what I was about to say. I think, well, first of all, let's take a step back and say, is Anil Kumble and is Virat Kohli good people? Are they good people? Yes. Anil Kumble is a class act and a gentleman. Virat Kohli is fiery and passionate. So together they should make a good combination. So the thing to me is, those two guys there now, they're the ones in charge. If the team don't play well in the first game or so, that's why the first game against Pakistan, I think in Birmingham is the first game, is so important. If they can win that first game, the rest of the stuff will go in the background and say, you know, it doesn't really affect that the guys are concentrating on the job. If they lose, especially to Pakistan the first game, you can imagine what it's going to be like.
It could be a downward spiral.
Trouble in the camp. So the first game, these guys have to be ready. So the one thing they have to concentrate on this next few days is get their head right more than anything else. They're going to be prepared, fine, with the bat and the ball, but their head right is the most important thing. And this is where that communication comes in that we talked about. So Virat now, this is a great opportunity for him as a captain to get the best out of his players. The captain, the best captains always get the best out of their players. They play above themselves, the players. So if Virat Kohli now should spend those next few days speaking to the players, having one-on-ones with the players, just taking guys out for a coffee and just having a general chat, make them feel not under pressure. Make them feel relaxed so they can perform well, because you've got quality, skilled players. If they feel under pressure, if they feel like the fear of failure is there, if they don't perform, they could get dropped or it's all going to hit the fan, then they will not perform. They just will not perform. They've got to be in the right headspace. And that is the thing that India need to work on in the next few days.
You know, I saw the team in the last two games on the 28th and the 30th. Yes, it's a warm-up game. I don't know whether Shane got an opportunity to watch it or Michael got an opportunity to watch it. The team's looking brilliant. You know, after a long time, and I've seen five bowlers for India who can pick wickets and who can get teams out in 50 overs. They got New Zealand out for 180 on a good oval pitch. And New Zealand is a good cricketing side, good one-day side. They got Bangladesh out for 90 yesterday. They got 300 themselves. And the same Bangladesh team got 350 against Pakistan,
yeah, right,
2 days ago. So those three quicks in Shami, Umesh and Bumrah, they've looked remarkably well and bowled with pace. You know, you sit behind and commentate, you see the ball hitting the glove. You see the ball hitting the glove and you realize, geez, these boys are looking good. So it's a good thing. India will still beat Pakistan whether Kumble and Virat are fighting or not, because that's what happened in the last 10 years. We are a better side than them in big tournaments. But I firmly believe and very rightly agree with Shane that this could be a very good combination if they keep their heads together.
Mm. Michael, you know, for Sourav, me, Vikrant, most of the audience here, India, Pakistan, there is emotion. I mean, we keep saying that for players, it's a cricket match, it's, you know, all of that. But when you hear the national anthem being played with your hand in your heart, it is politics. At one level, it is political. When you watch it from a distance, I mean, not being Indian or Pakistani, can you tell me what the mindset should be right? Like Shane mentioned, keep focus, keep your mindset right.
Yeah, there's no doubt you feel it as a player as well. I think that's what the big tournaments are about. And, you know, I think for Australia, the Ashes, for example, is like that. So whether you like it or not, there's so much build-up about that game around you, in particularly from the media, that you can't hide from it. So naturally, you, even if it's your subconscious, you're building up for it as well. I think the key to any success in big games or big tournaments is preparation. I know Warnie spoke about it earlier as well, listening to him. And why I say that is because then mentally and physically, you can just walk out and play. The emotion is going to be there. You can't run away from it. So accept that it's there. But the way you beat teams in big games or big tournaments is on skill and not emotion. And we used to talk about that as an Australian team, that no matter what you feel, no matter if there's a player, there's a bowler that you're facing that you don't like, that you've had a disagreement with, that you're not comfortable with, the actual bowler running into bowl is irrelevant. It's the ball that I have to face. So if the ball's coming down and it's swinging away, then I've got to find a way. Am I going to drive that ball? Am I going to let that ball go? If the ball's swinging back in, am I going to hit it off my pads? Am I going to block it? The guy who's running in to bowl that ball, it's actually irrelevant. And I think that's what India and Pakistan, both these two teams, need to do. The emotion will be there because it'll be built up from the public. But don't play on emotion. Don't play against the whole of India or the whole of Pakistan. As a player, face that ball. As a bowler, bowl that delivery.
Sort of when we were kids, Pakistan was much better than India. And we would lose. Two teams would go out and play and Pakistan would win. When you guys started playing and then India became strong, obviously Pakistan was losing more than they would win. Isn't it ironical and bad for India that due to the political circumstances, we don't play Pakistan as often? Because if we play them more often, we would obviously beat them more often.
Yeah, it's true.
It's just a suggestion.
Yeah,
there's emotion right there.
No, it's mathematics. Yeah, it's maths.
It's true, to be honest, because we are a much better side than they are. And since 1999, you know, if you look at the record, it's just been one way. And you know, whether it's test matches, whether it's one-day cricket, whether it's T20 cricket, you know, it's just been one way for India and maybe one odd losses here and there. But at the same time, you know, terrorism is very important. You know, you cannot just kill people all the time on the border. And every day you wake up and see the soldiers being killed, their heads being chopped off, their arms being chopped off. It's not a great sight. So it's a completely political decision, and that's how it's going to be. You know, whether you like it or you don't like it, that's how it's going to be, and you have to deal with it. You know, different political parties have come in, and it's remained the same for all of them.
Absolutely. In fact, you know, and we at India Today and Aaj Tak respect that it's a political call, and when the government says no to a bilateral series, for sure. But sort of coming to India-Pakistan, and I'm going to ask Shane this as well, 2003 India versus Pakistan Centurion, perhaps one of the most pressured games in Indian cricket history, you captain. What do you tell your players? How do you deal with that situation? And when you beat Pakistan, do you get ahead of yourself? Because you still have two games to go. It's like the final before the final, the World Cup has ended.
You just prepare yourself well, that's all. You know, you cannot just keep talking about Pakistan, because there are other teams to beat. You know, we came in 2003, or whichever team walked into any championship, it's about getting to the final and winning it. Whether it's India, Pakistan, whether it's Australia, England, you know, it's the same. So you just cannot focus on one team. You come to play a tournament. Yes, you know certain games are a bit more important than the other, but the 2003 Pakistan side was the top side. You know, we worked hard, we prepared hard, and we just batted them out of the game. And that's probably the best Pakistan side which has played against India since 2003. It's been 14 years now. So that's how you play. You don't just overburden yourself with one team. You know, just go and play your best and take game after the other.
Incidentally, Borya, we've got three legends here, and we've got three legends in the among the audience. I think an applause would be in order for them. We've got Graham Smith, Kumar Sangakkara, and Mohammad Azharuddin. Very engrossing, otherwise. Shane Warne and Sourav Ganguly, that banter of theirs, it's still on. After so many years.
Has it ever happened in a cricket conclave in India or any part of the world that we have a galaxy of this? So to that, to the India Today group and Aaj Tak, can we have a round of applause, please? Because it's self, you know, patting on the back kind of thing, but I don't think it has happened before. And Graham, you missed Sourav sledging Shane and Shane sledging Sourav on stage. That was quite interesting to start off
with. You agree
with
that his hair does look great.
It does. It does.
And have you been following Sangha? You know, 500s in a row? She said, why did you stop playing for Sri Lanka? You know, 500s in a row.
Hair is the topic of discussion today. The moment Sourav said, Sangha said hair, and Sourav's hair, Shane
won't believe. I can see a few grey ones there. The Sam is still fine.
The same solution's been recommended
in order,
to me as
so.
Well.
There you go.
By Sourav.
Yeah.
Yes.
The best in the business.
Yes.
Advanced Hair Studios, free consultation.
Another endorsement.
So free? Yeah. So Shane.
Yes.
You know, my final question before I open this up. 1999 World Cup, Australia, South Africa, 213, not good enough, seems at least. And then suddenly comes Shane Warne, match turns over on its head. You know, in situations like this, when one player or two players sort of just rise like a phoenix, take it as a talisman and turns things around, do you see that in Virat Kohli, in this Indian team?
Oh, I love the spirit and passion that Virat Kohli plays in. A bit like Sourav touched on before, he probably gets involved in a few too many things, like every single incident he's involved in. And that can eat away at your brain all the time and not allow you the time to think about other things and be a few overs ahead of the game in the shorter forms. And in longer forms, think about strategic-y stuff and tactical side of things that maybe he just needs to sit back and just watch for a little bit and just keep a bit calm. And that portrays the rest of his team. When he does play with that passion, which I love, sometimes the rest of his team follow suit with that. And there's no calmness about that. There are some irrational shots plays and some fast forward. The game's in fast forward. Test cricket is a marathon, not a sprint. You've got to take your time. You've got to think things through. There's times when you need to really attack. There are times when you need to defend. There are times when the game is sort of nothing. But there's really times where you need to take stock and recharge and plug yourself back in and get ready for the next assault. So there are different times like that. But I really love Virat Kohli. I still believe he's the best player in the world at the moment, across the board in all forms. You know, the Steve Smiths is very good. His record is amazing. You know, there's so many other good players. Joe Root from England's a good player. De Villiers is a good player. There are other wonderful players, but I think Virat Kohli's got the chance to be a match winner. In no matter what, like the one-day cricket in this Champions Trophy that we're here for, his 50-over record chasing scores is uncanny how many times he's made 100 when they've been tough, in all conditions, not just in India, but in all conditions. So to me, he's going to be the standout player for this tournament, one to watch. If he stands up, he keeps calm about things. I think he'll portray that with his team. He'll captain the side better. And in the end of the day, he's there to make runs. He's their best player.
You mentioned about the 99 semi-final. My favourite is the 96 semi-final, Mohali, when single-handedly Shane Warne turned the game around. Shane, the last Champions Trophy, and me and Dada were here, England had prepared dry pitches because they wanted to win the Ashes and they had good spinners. Would you foresee a situation where the Indian spinners will have a larger role to play like they had in 2013? Would the pitches be drier this time?
Well, the weather's been pretty good. I mean, I've only been here for a few days, but the weeks leading up to this, the weather's been really good. So the pitches, I think, are going to be quite dry. I think the spinners, as I said earlier, I think India are in a situation at the moment where they've got variety in their attack. And as a captain, when you've got variety in your attack and you can throw the ball to a fast bowler or a spinner, depending on the conditions, no matter what conditions everyone prepares, India have got the bowling side to handle that, no matter what the conditions. So for me, I think the bowlers are going to play a big part. The spinners, all teams don't play the spinners as well as in previous years gone by, and when teams have struggled, it's generally been against spin. So I think if these pitches are dry, then I think the guys like Ashwin and Jadeja and those guys are going to have big roles to play.
Michael, Sourav, do we actually start overwhelming favourites against Pakistan given the quality of the side, leaving the emotion apart?
Oh, definitely. I think India's a much better looking team on paper. That doesn't guarantee success, but I think India won the last Champions Trophy. They go into this tournament as favourites. You know, obviously I'm Australian. I think the Australian have a really good team. I think if anything, the Australian team's probably lacking a frontline spinner, and I think they have to pick Adam Zampa in every game for exactly what Warnie was talking about, that variation to be able to use the, even if the wickets don't spin. A spinner can slow the game up. A spinner can hold the ball in the pitch. It doesn't necessarily need to turn, especially to a new batsman starting their innings. It can be quite difficult to score. So I think you need variety. I think you need the quicks and the spin. So I'm predicting Australia-India final.
Sourav, he's predicted an Australia-India final.
Well, too early, to be honest. I don't predict in this game. England is very good. Yeah. England is a good side. You know, when you watch them play in these conditions, the number of match winners they have, you just cannot rule them out. South Africa, the way they bowled at Lord's.
How many match winners have England got? How many do you reckon?
Stokes, Butler. They've got a good bowling attack. I think they're a good side. I firmly believe they're a good side, better than Australia at the moment. I think so, yeah.
You think England will beat Australia? On June the 10th, I think the game is.
I would back actually.
You're buying me dinner if Australia win, and fair it, it won't be McDonald's.
Okay. I would actually back England to win.
Okay, that's what I'm saying. I'll buy you dinner if England win.
Fair enough.
And if Australia win, you have to wear... Okay, one more thing.
Okay.
If Australia win, you have to wear an Australian shirt for the day. And if England win, I'll wear an England shirt.
No problem. Not a problem.
Okay, and when
this
they do that... When they do that, we at India Today will be over there at the dinner to record that conversation and play it out to our viewers. You've promised each other at the conclave, so agree to that, please.
Okay, we just agreed. Didn't we? Did we agree?
We agree. Okay, on that note, there's agreement all round. Shane Warne, Sourav Ganguly agreeing with each other. A very rare feat. On that note, can we open it up for some questions, please? Questions, sir? Yes, at the back, right there. Please introduce yourself, sir, and fire away. Wait, one second. Take a microphone. There is the microphone.
Hi, I'm Neeraj. Firstly, as a social cricketer driving up and down English villages every Saturday and Sunday, what an honor and what a treat to have your legends here. So thank you so much for that. I have a question for Sourav, if I may. Sourav, from our generation of original Indians, you were the greatest cricket captain that we had, because just like Shane mentioned earlier, you put the fire in the belly of the team. And even though Sourav was blessed with an incredible side, to get them all firing together was truly sensational for our generation. You didn't take a backward step. I have a question, if you could give us any insight as to how you, your art of captaincy, how did you, I know when you're playing for your country, you're already motivated and you had an amazing side with you. But was there, was it your communication skills, or was it something else that instilled that spirit in the side? Because we always saw that passion, especially playing outside India.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, I think what you said very rightly at the start, I was fortunate enough to have a very good side. You know, some terrific players, terrific batsmen who went all around the world and scored runs. Two spinners who were outstanding, because I firmly believed in Test cricket, you needed good spinners to win. You know, when Sri Lanka were at their best, or when Australia were at their best, you know, they had the likes of Warne, Murli. And for us, it was Anil Kumble and Harbhajan Singh from both ends. They're a key part of any Test side. So I was fortunate enough to captain a side. I thought the players during that period of 5 years were at their best. And the likes of Sachin, Dravid, Lakshman, they played their best cricket during that period. So I was fortunate enough to be a part of it during that span. And then my job was actually, as Shane said, of a captain, was to make sure everything is right, to make sure the atmosphere is right, make sure they are in the best state of mind to play the game. Because I didn't have to teach Sachin Tendulkar or ask him to play the straight drive, or speak to Rahul Dravid or VVS Lakshman to hit through the onside. So for me, it was important that I kept everyone going, kept everyone involved in the team, because that's the biggest challenge. When you have a lot of great players who are such match winners on their own, it's important to keep the flock together. So that's what I did. You know, some of those reactions on the ground was because of pressure. You know, you want to win. There's so much at stake when you're captain of India. So it just came out of pressure, and it was not scripted or designed for that particular moment. But I firmly believe it's the team what you have.
You know, we've got time for one question. And with Kumar and Graham Smith here, will one of you ask a question of these three you've played with? You know, you've shared dressing rooms in different sides, but, you know, one from Graham, one from Sangha. Let's finish off that way. I can't miss a chance as a journalist
should ask Sangha a question. You'll have a lot of time to hear him. You'll have a lot of time to hear him. You know, he was such a remarkable player, such a remarkable batsman. You know, what keeps him going? County cricket, 500s in the season, already in 5 games. You know, it's something which everyone should know, that what keeps you going, what you still do to perform so well.
I think flat wickets help, number one. I think it's been a question. I had a call from Michael Atherton asking me the same thing, and the motivation is always not so, I would say, high-minded. You know, sometimes it's just about making sure that there's personal pride. I've been fortunate enough to play 15 and a half years of international cricket. There's also the fact that I'm the only overseas player, and whether I've achieved good things or whether I've had an okay career, it doesn't really matter. When you're put in a situation where there's competition, you really want to win. You want to come out on top, and you want to still prove, not just to the opposition, but also mostly to yourself, that if you are still playing this game, you got to play it well. So I think, those are the driving factors. When you go out there, it just happens, even in a warm-up game, I think, when we play soccer just before we start. And if you're, you know, part of a team, you try and win. Even though it's supposed to be a friendly game, you know, it starts off like that. I think during the Masters, when all of we were there, when the All-Stars went to America, just before we crossed the line, you know, the talk is always, let's go out there, have some fun, you know, let's make sure they get some runs.
He wasn't having
we'll
fun,
chase
though.
It down.
He was whacking everyone into the stands.
But I
told Sachin, I said, he cannot be playing the Masters because he's still not retired yet.
But the funniest thing is, you know, Warne would have a chat to all of us. Everyone's like, yeah, you know, let's hopefully they'll get a good total. We'll try and chase. Let's all have fun. Cross the boundary line. Within 5 minutes, that's all gone out the window. You know, ball in hand, bat in hand, fielding, everyone's suddenly gone really serious. Yeah. So I think you can't take that competitiveness out of any one of us if we're put back in a competitive arena.
Sorry. Ladies and gentlemen, for the record, Kumar Sangakkara retired with a test average of 57 plus.
Yeah.
Okay. And so that's the kind of record.
And look at his dismissals as a wicketkeeper as well. A quick snap pull.
Graham has a question, then you finish that off. Graham, question.
Smithers.
You know, the word around in England is Graham hitting the gym every day? It is, actually.
It's because I need to at this stage. I actually don't have a question, but maybe to you guys, you know, on South Africa's bowling lineup, how would you go about selecting that? I think that's the big talk at the moment. Would you play Morkel or would you go with the three all-rounders?
I think with South Africa's team at the moment, South Africa haven't played as well as they would have liked in the recent 3-1 days. They did well yesterday, won the game convincingly. I think having the three all-rounders in is a bit of an overkill. I want specialists that can win me the game. Morkel, to me, is a guy that can win you the match. We talked about match winners before. Sourav said England have got a couple. Australia have probably got 4 or 5. South Africa have got some match winners too. They've probably got 3 or 4 match winners in there. And Morkel is one of those guys. If he gets on a roll early doors against a top order, he could take 2 or 3 early wickets and get in that middle order. And that means then the team just bats through and tries to post a decent total that they can defend. So for me, I'll be playing, you know, 1 or 2 all-rounders, but I'll be playing match winners. If they believe that the all-rounders can win you the game with the ball, then pick them. But I think Morkel is a specialist. And it's very rare to have a specialist match winner,
no,
especially a Mornay Morkel. So for me, I'd be playing Morkel every single time.
Snap one. You've seen Sachin's movie?
No, I haven't. Not yet.
You're part Sourav? Of it.
Am I? Okay.
Sourav?
Great.
Sourav has, because he posted some photographs on Facebook.
I have seen his film. I saw it in England the other day.
Did you like it?
I liked it, but I wasn't overjoyed because everything what I saw, I knew. You know, I followed him since he was a 14-year-old kid. So all what he said on TV was known to me. But someone like a young cricketer who hasn't seen Sachin so closely will actually love it. So my daughter was sitting next to me and I was telling her that, you know, this is what he did then. This is what he did then. Because I've shared the dressing room with him for 16 years. So you actually know every bit. It's like Michael Clarke or Warne or Sangha or Mahela. They would actually know in and out of their lives. So it was not something new to me, but I think it's a great inspiration.
Supriya Bose has an idea. Why don't we make a movie on you? The next biopic.
Okay.
Dada.
We'll have a chat.
Sourav, what's that? A movie, did you say? Hey, mate, if they want to make a movie about me too, don't worry, it's the same thing.
Should he make a movie about him or not, Michael?
I reckon it'd be one of the all-time great hits if Warnie does a movie. I think it'd be great for everybody to see.
And
you'd want a star in your movie, though.
It'll be a more blockbuster than anyone. I thought MS Dhoni's film was very good.
Yep.
Sachin's were good. But if you do it, Jesus.
Okay, on that note, geez, Shane Warne's biopic, once it's unleashed to the world, we'll have the premiere and then soon after, Shane Warne on India Today, along with Michael Clarke and Sourav Ganguly, and Shane will do that jig for us. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been absolutely delightful, 45-odd minutes with 3 of the legends of the game. Round of applause for Michael Clarke, Sourav Ganguly and Shane Warne.
Bye, mate.